Now here in this lecture we will learn about the general organization of the parasympathetic nervous system. Now in the previous lecture you have been taught about the general organization of the autonomic nervous system as a whole, and also we have discussed the detailed organization of the sympathetic nervous system. So after this lecture you will be clear about the basic anatomical difference between the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system. Now coming to the physiological anatomy of the parasympathetic nervous system. Now you know that the parasympathetic fibers, they are also called as a craniosacral outflow, unlike that of the sympathetic nervous system, that is called as a thoracolumbar outflow. So here, as the name suggests, the cell bodies of the parasympathetic fibers, they lie in the cranium, that is in the brain stem, and in the few sacral segments of the spinal cord. So here this is a cranial outflow, and here it is the sacral outflow. So that's why the parasympathetic fibers are called as a craniosacral outflow. So now first about the cranial parasympathetic outflow. So the cranial outflow in the parasympathetic system, in which the cell bodies of the neuron that give rise to the preganglionic fibers lies in the general visceral efferent nuclei. So the parasympathetic system ke cranial part mein se fibers arise honge, they lie in various nuclei that are called as a parasympathetic nuclei, or they are called as a general visceral efferent nuclei. So these nuclei that are present within the brain stem, that are the parasympathetic cranial nuclei. So the various nuclei that are seen here are in the midbrain, that is also called as a tectal outflow. Okay, that includes the Edinger-Westphal nucleus, and second it is a bulbar outflow that includes the superior salivary nucleus, then lacrimal nucleus, then inferior salivary nucleus, and the dorsal vagus nuclei. So these are the nuclei of the parasympathetic fibers lies in the cranium, that is in the brain stem. And then second are the sacral part that lie in the sacral segment of the spinal cord, mainly at the S2 and S3 level. And here in the sacral outflow, the cell bodies that are present in the intermediolateral gray horn of the spinal cord, as we have seen in the sympathetic nervous system also, where the cell bodies of that thoracolumbar outflow that lie in the intermediolateral gray horn of the spinal cord. So there is a sacral sympathetic outflow that includes the pre and postcranial fiber both. Now, like that of the sympathetic fibers, this parasympathetic system is also under the influence of the higher centers, mainly the hypothalamus. So, just the sympathetic system is under regulation of the hypothalamus and the limbic system, here also parasympathetic fibers are also highly influenced by the higher centers, mainly the hypothalamus. Now, then coming to the individual nuclei, from where which the parasympathetic fibers will arise, and then they will terminate over the target tissue. And the first and most important nuclei, it is the Edinger-Westphal nuclei. Now, it lies in the midbrain, and the preganglionic fiber from this Edinger-Westphal nuclei, they will pass through the oculomotor nerve, that is the third cranial nerve, and they will relay in the ganglion that is known as the ciliary ganglion. So from Edinger-Westphal nuclei, the fiber will pass through the oculomotor nerve, and from the ciliary ganglion, that is also called as a peripheral parasympathetic ganglion, the postganglionic fiber, they will leave the ganglia through the short ciliary nerves, and that will supply finally to the sphincter pupillae and the ciliary muscle. So here this Edinger-Westphal nuclei, they will give rise to the oculomotor nerve that will relay over the ciliary ganglion, and from where the postganglionic fiber, finally they will terminate over the sphincter pupillae and the ciliary muscle through the short ciliary nerves. So you can see this nuclei, the upper one that lies in the midbrain, this is the Edinger-Westphal nuclei, from which the preganglionic fiber, they will travel through the third cranial nerve, that is oculomotor nerve. So the preganglionic fiber lies in this oculomotor nerve. They will terminate over the ciliary ganglion, and from the ciliary ganglion, the postganglionic fiber, they will finally terminate to innervate the ciliary muscles and the sphincter pupillae muscle of the eye through the short ciliary nerve. The next, the bulbar outflow, that includes the first one, a superior salivary nuclei, that from which the preganglionic fiber enter the facial nerve. The preganglionic fiber from the superior salivary nucleus, they will pass on through the facial nerve and they will relay at the submandibular ganglion. And the postganglionic fiber from this ganglion, they will pass to the submandibular and sublingual salivary glands. Now you are aware about the salivary gland that are concerned with the salivary secretion. The three types of the salivary gland: submandibular, sublingual, and the parotid. So the submandibular and the sublingual glands that are innervated by the facial nerve, okay, whose cell bodies lies in the superior salivary nuclei. Okay. Then the inferior salivary nucleus, that is again concerned with the salivation, which send the preganglionic fiber into the ninth cranial nerve, that is the glossopharyngeal nerve. And that preganglionic fiber, they will relay in the otic ganglion. And from the otic ganglion, the postganglionic fiber will arise and they will finally terminate to innervate the parotid gland. That is, again, one of the major salivary gland. So these are the two important salivary gland that are supplying the salivary nucleus, rather, that are concerned with the innervation to the salivary glands. So here, the next one from above part, this next one, it is the superior salivary nuclei. Okay. The superior salivary nucleus give rise to the preganglionic fiber. They will enter the fascia, this facial nerve, and that fiber they will relay over the submandibular ganglion, and then the postganglionic fiber from the submandibular ganglion, they will innervate this sublingual and the submandibular gland. And here, this is the inferior salivary nucleus. The third one from the uppermost part, this is the inferior salivary nucleus. They will give rise to the preganglionic fiber that will enter the ninth cranial nerve. Glossopharyngeal nerve will relay at the otic ganglion, and from where the postganglionic fiber will innervate the parotid gland. Then next nucleus of this parasympathetic fiber is the lacrimal nucleus. Now this lacrimal nucleus, it is you can tell it is a part of the superior salivary nucleus. It lies along the superior salivary nucleus, or you can also call it as a subdivision of the superior salivary nucleus. The preganglionic fiber from this lacrimal nucleus, it will pass on its fiber through the facial nerve. And that preganglionic fiber through the facial nerve, they will relay at the pterygopalatine ganglion. And from this pterygopalatine ganglion, the postganglionic fiber will reach to its innervating organ, that is a lacrimal gland, that are concerned with the lacrimation. So clear, so there is a lacrimal gland nucleus. So you can see this is a superior salivary nucleus along which the lacrimal nucleus is also situated. So from lacrimal nucleus, the preganglionic fiber will pass on through the facial nerve. Okay. And that fiber of the facial nerve that are concerned with the lacrimation, they will relay at the pterygopalatine ganglion. And then finally, they will innervate the lacrimal glands and also the nasal gland. So, यहाँ पे आप देख सकते हैं फेशियल नर्व के फाइबर, उसमें दो तरह के फाइबर, एक तो लैक्रिमल सिक्रेशन के भी फाइबर्स है, बट दैट आर रिलेइंग ओवर टेरिगोपेलेटाइन गैंग्लियन। उसके अलावा सलाइवरी ग्लैंड के भी फाइबर है, बट दैट आर रिलेइंग ओवर द सबमेंडिबुलर गैंग्लियन। सो दिस अनदर फाइबर, एंड नेक्स्ट कमिंग टू द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट एंड द मेजर न्यूक्लियस ऑफ दिस पैरासिम्पेथेटिक न्यूक्लियाई, there is a dorsal motor nucleus of the vagus, or simply you can call it as a dorsal nucleus of the vagus. So approximately 75% of all the parasympathetic fibers arise from it. Okay. So jo sare ke sare parasympathetic fibers hai, usme se 75% fibers that lie in the vagus now. So it is the one of the major part of the parasympathetic system, vagus now, and the nucleus of the vagus, that is a major part here. So the preganglionic fiber traveling in the vagus nerve, and they will end in the ganglia that are closely related to the visceral organs. So jahan pe vagus fibers jo travel hote preganglion, uske jo ganglia hote that are basically lying near to or within the innervating structure. These structures ko supply karte ya to uske wall mein honge ya fir just near to that. So उसके जो पोस्ट गैंग्लियन फाइबर्स है दे आर वेरी वेरी शॉर्ट. सो द पोस्ट गैंग्लियन फाइबर्स रन अ शॉर्ट कोर्स टू सप्लाई द स्मूथ मसल्स एंड ग्लैंड्स इन दैट पर्टिकुलर ऑर्गन. So this lower most fiber nucleus, that is the vagus nucleus or a dorsal vagus nucleus, which give rise to the preganglionic fiber that will pass on through the 10th cranial nerve, that is the vagus nerve, and it is innervating many of the tissues. So almost 75% of the total fiber of the parasympathetic fiber, they lie in the vagus nerve. Okay. And this vagus nerve innervate the heart and most of the GI structures. Then the sacral parasympathetic outflow. So this is all about the cranial outflow. Okay, so in the cranial outflow, the preganglionic fibers, they are passing through the various cranial nerves, mainly the third cranial nerve, seventh cranial nerve, ninth cranial nerve, and the 10th cranial nerve. And then the sacral parasympathetic outflow, where the preganglionic fiber, they will arise from the cell bodies that lie at the sacral segment of the spinal cord, mainly the S2 and S3, but it may be sometimes also in the S4 and S1. So the cell bodies of these preganglionic fibers that are located in the intermediolateral gray horn of the sacral space segment of the spinal cord. The axons of these, they form the preganglionic fiber that pass through the ventral spinal root of the corresponding nerve, like that of the sympathetic fiber. And the axon that leave the spinal nerves to form the pelvic splanchnic nerves, and that will end in the pelvic autonomic plexuses. So the postganglionic fiber that are located in the pelvic autonomic plexuses that are lying close to or within the viscera, again like that of the that vagus fiber. And the axon, the postganglionic fibers run very short course to supply the concerned pelvic viscera. Okay, so the sacral segment of the spinal cord, basically it is concerned with the innervation to the various pelvic viscera, but also it is supplying to some of the GI tract tissues. So these fibers ends also supply the rectum, sigmoid colon, descending colon, and the left 1/3 of the transverse colon. Okay. So mainly they are concerned with the innervation to the pelvic viscera, but also it is supplying to the certain structure of the GI tract. So you can see this is the spinal cord, and this is the lowest segment of the spinal cord that includes the sacral segment. So from the S2 and S3 mainly, but it may be also from the S4. The preganglionic fiber from the intermediolateral gray horn of the spinal cord, they will arise, and through the pelvic splanchnic nerve, they will innervate the various pelvic organs and also certain tissue of this GI tract. So these all are the pelvic organs to which this fibers will supply, that include the bladder, the uterus, and the genitalia. So this about the various cranial fibers and also the sacral fibers. So this figure, it is just a summary of all these things that we have discussed here. So again, just I am briefing this. These parasympathetic fibers are also called as a cranial sacral outflow. So this is the cranial outflow through that arise whose cell bodies lies in the various nuclei that include the Edinger-Westphal nuclei, superior syllabary nucleus, with that is the lacrimal nucleus, then the inferior syllabary nucleus, and then the vagus nucleus or a dorsal nucleus of the vagus, from which the preganglionic fiber through the third cranial nerve, seventh cranial nerve, ninth cranial nerve, and the 10th cranial nerve, it will innervate the various tissues. And second is the sacral outflow from the S2 and S3. They are innervating the various pelvic viscera and also certain tissues of the GI tract. So clear? So this is the important aspect regarding the physiological anatomy of the parasympathetic nervous system, and I hope you understood this. And just brief about the parasympathetic efferent fibers that are a sensory fiber that are important for a reflex arc. So the efferent fibers are a myelinated fiber that travel from the viscera, various viscera, to their cell bodies that are located either in the sensory ganglia of the cranial nerve, that means the nucleus that are lie in the brainstem, or they goes to the cell bodies that lie in the posterior root of the ganglia of the sacrospinal nerves. The central axons of these then enter the central nervous system and take part in the formation of the local reflex arc, or they may pass to the higher center of the autonomic nervous system. Now something about the interactions of the autonomic divisions. So you will learn in detail about this in the further lectures also, but just have a brief look or a brief idea about the effect of the two autonomic divisions. Okay, how this sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system, they are having effect over the various tissues. Just we will see briefly, detail we will see in the further lectures. So the most of the visceral organs that are innervated by both the parasympathetic and the sympathetic fibers. So most of the viscera, whether they are GI tract or pelvic organs or heart tissue, etc., they are innervated by both these fibers, sympathetic as well as the parasympathetic fiber. But at most of the place, the effect of this both the system, it is the opposite. So there is a dynamic antagonism. You will see the dynamic antagonisms. Antagonism means opposite effect of the both the system over a same tissue or organ, and that is important to precisely control the various visceral activity. So as for example, you can see that the sympathetic fibers, they will increase the heart and the respiratory rate while they are inhibiting the digestion and the elimination. But on the opposite side, parasympathetic fibers, they will decrease the heart rate and also the respiratory rate while they will allow for the digestion and the discarding of the waste. So both the system are having effect over all the tissue, but that effect will be opposite. So that will help to control the various visceral activity. Then something about the, again, the activity of the sympathetic fiber and the behavior of the parasympathetic fiber. So sympathetic fibers, they are diffuse. That means the sympathetic system usually fires diffusely. इसका मतलब है कि सिंपैथेटिक फाइबर जब एक्टिवेट होंगे सो मोस्ट ऑफ द गैंग्लियन विल बी एक्टिवेटेड, दे विल बी स्टिमुलेटेड एंड यू विल सी द मल्टीपल इफेक्ट्स ओवर मोस्ट ऑफ द ऑर्गन्स दे आर इनर्वेटिंग. बट पैरासिंपैथेटिक फाइबर्स में इट इज क्वाइट डिफरेंट, दीज फाइबर्स आर डिस्क्रीट. सो जब पैरासिंपैथेटिक सिस्टम एक्टिवेट होगी देन इट विल फायर डिस्क्रीटली. डिस्क्रीटली मीन्स कि वहाँ पर डिफ्यूज फायरिंग नहीं होगा. सो देयर विल बी अ इंडिपेंडेंट एक्टिविटी, किसी एक टिश्यू पे ही मोस्टली एक्टिविटी होगी. So it is a type of the discrete or independent activity. As for example, मतलब कि lacrimal nucleus activate हुए then there will be only lacrimation. उसके साथ salivation होगा, gastric secretion बढ़ेगा, इस तरह की चीज़ होना it is not compulsory. So there may be a single activity only. So parasympathetic fiber, it is a type of the discrete activity, while the sympathetic fiber has a diffuse activity. So this is, I think, all about the important aspect regarding the physiological anatomy of the parasympathetic nervous system, and just brief about the effect of this both the divisions. The detail about the each effect and role that we will see later on. So in the next lecture you will learn about the various autonomic neurotransmitters and the receptors and their effect. Okay. Thank you.